potential to window around the world.
So that's kind of a variation of this.
All right. Any clarification needed at this stage? No?
What exactly is the sequence like in American? Is that the thing you're trying to translate?
The sequence would be a sentence, for instance. So it means the unit, one sample is the unit, and this unit is the sequence which can be at variable length. And then your cell will process this this sentence. And if you have, like, for instance, 64 cells in your model, each cell which process the same sentence differently. As opposed to a feed-forward where you have 64, you know, horizontally, and it's processed this way. So if you want, the sequence is processed entirely by every cell. Yeah?
So generally, n will be much smaller than d.
Well, d is like 512. If you process sentences, it would be the case. A sentence would be 50 words, whatever. If you wanted to process a paragraph or a book, because if you process sentences, if you say, my cat is named Polly, and she's very temperamental. It's two sentences. The system has no ways to know that she refers to Polly. So, in foreign languages, when objects have a gender, for instance, there might be ambiguity there. Okay, but yeah, if it's a sentence, probably it would be much easier then, right? Okay. So, just a very quick refresher on recurrent networks. This is all taken from the deep learning book. So basically, as we were saying, each cell processes a sequence, which is very well suited to sequences of variable length. And to keep memory from one step to the other, it keeps an internal state. That's the trick, in fact, that they use. So the way they represented it, like this way, you have the cell, you have the internal state. You enter the next element of the sequence. So basically, my sequence is, or my sentence is x1, x2, x3, x4, x5. And this is every time one pops up. It takes me to an internal state, which uses, this square means the previous sequence. So it takes the previous state and calculates the next internal state and the output. And then the output is evaluated with a loss function against the target, if that makes sense. So if you unroll it, I start, for instance, with my beginning of sentence token. So I have my previous state. I enter, I calculate from my previous state and my new word a new internal state, which gives me an output, and then the next stage, and so on and so forth. So this way I'm able to carry information for a previous state, and the beauty of it is here, this state conveys the information of all the previous words, basically. So in theory, and what's interesting about this model, I saw in a presentation, that, you know, based on the statistical model of language, you want to calculate the probability of one word based on all the previous words, yeah? And then, again and again, you do the chain probability of the probability of the sentence. If you try to think, okay, I would like to make a model, a language model based on this, very quickly, you get onto these recurrent networks, because then you have the probability of the next word based on the sentence up to there, and so on and so forth. So it's kind of a natural model for statistical language modeling. Anyway. All right. So, any question on this?
When you say that we hear a sentence, we go word by word, but isn't it typically that we read the whole sentence in our brains first and then?
Sure. No, in fact, this, in this case, it wouldn't work very well, because first you can process only a sentence of equal number of words. You're right, it wouldn't work at all in this case. This just works to translate a sequence into a sequence of the same length.
Yeah.
Maybe if you want to project cells, for instance, every time you have a new cells of the day, you want to project the weather forecast, you have the forecast of the day, you want the weather forecast the next day, you know, this would actually make sense.
Yeah.
But because more than that for translation, this will not work at all.
Because in many arguments, the new information also changes the belief about the old part.
Exactly. I don't know if you have heard this, but this say that every new information brings some understanding at the beginning of the sentence.
Yes.
Yeah, I don't speak German. The German, probably the verb is at the end of the sentence, so I suppose it would be difficult to draw conclusions until the end. Yeah. So, just to zoom on the LSTM, The LSTM is a specific form of a recurrent network, but just because people notice that for the long range dependencies, the beauty of it, if here I have my kind of world, my car, which is blue, but the fact that it's blue happens only here, sometimes this information is lost in the chain of the network, right? So it would be great to be able to better control the flow, because it's like a vanishing gradient. Every time the information is processed, it is reduced and kind of potentially lost. So it would be great to control the flow of information through this. And that was the idea of the LSTMs, which is in fact introducing gates to get through the flow. In fact, this is from the original paper, which is 1997. But on the web, you find like easier representations of it. So the idea is basically you have your internal state that comes in, you have your new world that comes, and here you have a forget gate. Based on your internal state of the new world, you decide what parts of the previous state you want to forget, basically. Then you move forward. Here, based on your new input as well, you decide. You create your new input and the previous output. You decide what new you want to add. And here, you decide how much you want to add to your knowledge. So you have a new state, which is in part of the past, but you've controlled how much of the past you want. Part of an update, but you've decided how much of the update you want. And it goes to be in the next stage. And part of this new internal state is outputted. Until next time, basically. All right? So there are LSTMs, there are something called GRUs, gated recurrent units, which is the same system with less gates. But all the idea is to be able to control the flow of information and to say, okay, I have a bypass, make sure that I keep what's interesting and I lose what is not. Right? Okay. So variations on the LSTMs, instead of inputting an output every time, you just do nothing. You just take a final output, which sometimes is the final internal state, and then you evaluate the loss. So basically, you have one sequence, and you input only one output. All right, so that's one variation. Other variation is the symmetrical one. You take only one context. And all this is from your deep learning, so read that already. So every time you take the same context vector, and you get a different output. For instance, this can be used in image captioning. It's always the same image, and you create a sentence based on the image, but it's always the same sentence. So, I mean, this seems to be like, I think, fairly, when you have the previous idea, this idea seems to be fairly simple, in a way. And the LSTM was from 1997. The next idea, which was in 2014, which is the beginning of the neural machine translation, actually, so not long ago, is this super simple idea, to put, first of all, an LSTM in one output, and then an LSTM in one input. In fact, the combination of the two things we've seen before. So you summarize the sentence into one representation, as you were saying, using all the information. And once it's done, you then create a new sentence. So it's two RNNs. First, it does the encoding. Then it does the decoding. And the beauty of it, of course, is that they can